You're on Meet the Press. Without the support of independent MP Andrew Wilkie, Julia Gillard's hold on government would be even more tenuous. The anti-poker machine MP is demanding gambling reform or else. He's threatening the jackpots of a $12 billion industry that entertains 600,000 gamblers a week. And someone, he says, has threatened his life.
I don't think it's wise for Andrew Wilkie or previously Tony Windsor or anyone else to start talking about personal threats associated with politics.
Let's welcome back to the program, Andrew Wilkie. Good morning, Mr. Wilkie.
Good morning.
Well, Joe Hockey there is stating what I suppose has been a law of politics, that if you are threatened, especially death threats, you tell the police but you don't tell anybody else. The clubs, of course, have picked this up and they're now accusing you of using these threats to smear them.
Well, I think it's right that, as a general rule, you wouldn't talk about such threats. And in fact, in my 8 years in public life, I've been threatened on a number of occasions. But this most recent threat was different. It came on the day that the poker machine industry launched its $20 million campaign against me and the government. The day that I also received an email threatening me with so-called compromising photos. The day that the media started to trawl over my Duntroon past. There was clearly, or is clearly, a campaign being waged against me. Understandably, you know, if you want to overturn poker machine reform, you run an advertising campaign, you lobby politicians and you try and destroy Andrew Wilkie. So I thought it was important that the community understood all of the different dimensions of this.
Talking of your Duntroon past, Mr. Wilkie, Brendan Etches is the fellow who was a cadet at ADFA when you were there, and he says you were involved with acts of bastardisation. Have you spoken to Brendan Etches yet? Are you going to apologise to him?
No, I'm meeting him, I believe, tomorrow. It might be Tuesday. And I'm looking forward to meeting Brendan and to talk about his concerns. I would make the point again that I genuinely have no memory of the incident he's alleging. But that's not some sort of politician's cop-out, because I've never made any secret of the fact, and I've written about this in a book in 2004, that I was involved in bastardisation at Duntroon. I was bastardised. I was a bastard. At the time, I thought it was fine. With the benefit of hindsight, I know it is appalling and wrong. And in fact, I applaud the Defence Minister for everything he's trying to do to now try and crack down on it.
So will you apologise to Brendan Etches? And how can you be clear that these issues coming up now aren't more to do with the ADFA scandal, bringing them to mind, rather than your anti-poker stance?
Well, I won't be able to apologise to him for an incident I have no memory of. I have already apologised to him and everyone, and I'll do the same again when I see him this week, to anyone who feels in any way aggrieved by anything I've ever said or done in my life or in my time at Duntroon. But it's a bit difficult for me to apologise for a particular incident that I have no memory of.
Mr. Wilkie, just on gambling reform, if you don't get what you want from the Gillard government, will you switch your support to Tony Abbott?
Look, there's been much made of the fact that I have a written agreement with Julia Gillard for poker machine reform, and you know that's in return for you know, my support for supply and confidence. And it's understandable that the media is very interested in, you know, what happens if the reforms don't go through? What will Wilkie do? I would actually prefer today to focus on the fact that at every turn, the government has shown goodwill towards me and these reforms, that it is doing everything I think it can reasonably do to progress them. It's already met its milestone of obtaining advice as to its constitutional competence to intervene in poker machine venues. It's on track to have an answer from all the states and territories by the end of May on whether or not they will cooperate. Jenny Macklin in particular, she's got something like 20 officials working in her department on this. Plus, I think I've got the numbers on the crossbench and in the parliament. So in essence, I am very confident that these poker machine reforms will go ahead.
Why are you so confident of those votes on the crossbench? Because Tony Windsor is clear at the moment he can't support the sort of reforms you're talking about. These reforms potentially will cost many, many hundreds of jobs and potentially see some clubs close down. The government's got a balancing act here. It's a key question of how much leeway you'll give the government and whether you will pull support. I mean, that's a key constitutional issue for us all.
Well, look, I won't give the government any leeway on this, and the government knows that. In regard to the numbers, look, Tony Windsor is a great man and a very smart man, and so far the only detailed information he has received is from the poker machine industry. I'm confident that when he sees the detail of the reforms, he will see the sense in them. But Tony Windsor's vote isn't crucial here. There are six crossbenchers. We need four votes. I'm one. The Greens are one. Bob Catt has already indicated strong support in principle for the reforms. I mean, we're almost there with just those three votes.
Mr. Wilkie, just on the carbon tax, just quickly, if the government doesn't get your vote on this issue, it will fall over. How are you likely to vote? How you stand on that issue?
Look, I've said for a long time that humanity is obviously influencing climate change, and that we have an obligation to do something about it. And I think the Australian government should act as quickly as it can, even if it's unilaterally. Now, I've also long said that putting a price on carbon, or in other words, a price on pollution, has to be central to the solution. So I am supportive in principle of what the government is doing currently. But of course, until I see the legislation and I'm assured that the settings are correct, it's impossible to go much further in my answer. Maybe the only way I would go further is to say I don't support any sort of scheme, I won't support any sort of scheme where all the money that's taken in is then paid back out. Particularly to the big polluters, or especially to the big polluters, because that undermines the whole purpose of having a tax on pollution.
What would you like to happen with that money? I mean, do you not agree that some sectors will need to have compensation if they're paying out? And this is, again, a question of jobs. I mean, how much do you have in mind to your own personal politic and then, in a separately, the issue of your electorates and the broader electorate?
Well, look, I think it's quite reasonable that there shouldn't be too big a jolt on the day this thing is turned on. As far as compensation goes, clearly the most disadvantaged members of our community, people on low incomes, I think they need some assistance and they should be compensated. But there's no point fully compensating...
But you can't compensate people if they lose their for losing their jobs. That's the argument the union and the industry are putting out now.
Oh, but look, let's face it, so much of what the industry is saying is a scare campaign. No one knows the detailed settings yet, so much of the conversation at the moment is baseless. I am confident that the government will come up with settings that are reasonable, that will allow market forces to push consumers towards cleaner products, will push manufacturers towards doing things more cleanly. If there are any manufacturers out there that simply can't clean up the act, then we need to ask ourselves, are they doing it the right way?
Mr. Wilkie, we have a question from Twitter from Zostar. Why doesn't the poker reforms or policy also apply to casinos?
Well, in fact, the reforms will apply to all pubs, all clubs and all casinos in the land. I have heard that question pop up a few times. I'm not sure of the reason for it. I suppose it's because the clubs industry and the hotels industry are the most vocal, and it's the clubs and hotels industries who are behind the $20 million disinformation campaign that was launched last Monday. But certainly my intention is that casinos are included in every way. I would point out that the Productivity Commission did raise the issue of foreign tourists, and whether or not foreign tourists should be dealt with differently. That's something that the committee has addressed, and the detail of that will be in the committee's report, which I'd expect to have out within a few weeks.
Thank you very much for joining us this morning, Andrew Wilkie. And thanks also to our panel, Nick Butterley and Fran Kelly. A transcript and a replay of this program will be on our website and our Facebook page. Until next week, goodbye.